Just about 3 minutes before we dropped our bombs on Bremen, two direct flak hits knocked out both our outer engines. From then on, we knew that it was going to be rough. Even if our two engines would get us back to base, we were a dead pigeon from then on for the enemy fighters. Our wingships kept with us until we made the bombing run, and then they had to leave us and rejoin the formation. As we left the formation, we could see fighters waiting for straggling ships like us. The first attack by twin-engine fighters wasn't too successful, but that was only the first attack. Then we ran into a group of Focke-Wulf 190s. We were losing altitude and were practically helpless. They hit us badly on the first pass, and I heard Sergeant Vossler, our radio man, tell the pilot through the intercom that he'd been hit badly in the chest. Then the attack was on again, and pretty soon Vossler called and said that he had been hit again, this time in the legs. As soon as I could, I came down out of the turret and looked back through the ship at Vossler. He was lying on his back, holding his gun. In a few minutes, I managed to get back for another look, and this time, though he'd been hit again, he'd somehow pulled himself up onto the table and was manning his gun to protect our defenseless tail. The tail gunner had been hit on the first pass, too. Fighter attacks continued for 1 hour and 10 minutes, and by the time they'd finished, part of the control cables had been shot away. The ship was flying at a bad angle. There were very few instruments left intact, and 4 of us had been hit. The pilot told us to move everything movable up to the front of the ship to try to level it out. By this time, I figured that we were going to have to ditch. We were out over the North Sea, and it looked like it would be a long trip home. So everything that could be lifted was thrown out. Then I heard Sergeant Vossler saying over the intercom that he couldn't move it. I knew he'd been wounded by now in the chest, in the arm and leg, and also that he could no longer see. I figured he was talking about some part of his body. I went back to him and found that he had thrown out a good bit of ammunition already and was struggling to get rid of the rest. I told him to take it easy, but all he did was go back to his transmitter. It had been hit, but now that he was blind, he didn't know it, and I thought it was best not to tell him. All this time, he was sending out signals about our position and keeping the SOS messages going. Sometimes they got out, but mostly the transmitter was dead. Every time Vossler wanted to turn himself around to change a tuning unit, I had to move his leg around for him. I must have done it about 50 times. When he tried to turn by himself, the leg just stayed where it was. I waved my hand in front of his face, but he didn't flinch, so I knew that he was blind. I called the pilot and told him that we were ready for ditching. Vossler, who had overheard part of the conversation, asked me if I had thrown everything out. I told him yes, all except the pilot and co-pilot. I had only said that in a joking way to try and cheer him up, but he had discovered the hole in his transmitter, so the cat was out of the bag, and he probably knew it wasn't working. Then he asked me if I remembered the discussion when he told me if ever he was badly wounded, he wanted to be thrown out with a chute attached. Now he told me to do it. I told him that we were over the North Sea and there wasn't a hope of his being picked up in that condition. He said he didn't care but to throw him out with or without a chute. He said it would lighten the ship and make the gasoline last longer. He wasn't morose about it. He'd been thinking, and he said he was blind, his leg was no good, and he'd probably be dead by the time we got back to base anyway. He argued a long while, but I wouldn't do it. Then we ditched. Sergeant Vossler hadn't finished yet. One of the rafts stuck, but he dislodged it. Then the wounded tail gunner tumbled out onto the wing and wasn't strong enough to hold himself there. Vossler held him there until we could get back safely into the raft. And that's all for the story. We ditched near the English coast after 3 hours and 15 minutes over the sea. The wind had been against us, and the damaged plane slowed us down to about 80 miles an hour, and that is not fast. But when we ditched, we were lucky. A British trawler picked us up, and not so very much later, we were safe in a hospital.